aspect ratios. Photographers would take that quite serious during the film era. It was considered carefully before shooting. Now, with high resolution sensors giving us more than enough for cropping, camera brands, as well as photographers themselves, seem to kind of ignore the aspect ratio of their cameras. But I bet each of you at least once had been thinking, damn, I have to crop every shot I've taken today. And I've been there too, actually, I'm experiencing that shit from the very start right until now. While some may argue that in digital photography aspect ratio doesn't matter that much, others like me find it frustrating sometimes. Most of the popular cameras have a 3:2 ratio, but if you look through your final edits, you'll find out that most of them are more square than that weirdly long rectangular RAW files. So why in the world we have that stupid, inconvenient aspect ratio in our cameras? We'll dig into that today. Sup brothers and sisters, it's Aperture Value with a new history behind episode, and in this one we'll look into the history of photographic aspect ratios. In particular, the 3:2 ratio that is the most common, but also the most insufficient and inconvenient. No one would think of implementing something like that since the beginning of photography, until one German dude was hired by Ernst Lights. Oskar Barnack was an engineer working for Lights at the beginning of 20th century. Devoted to improving the cinema cameras, he was dealing with 35mm film a lot since it was the main format for movie cameras at the time. Contrary to relatively small cinema format, photography was mainly revolving around 8x10 film, which is just huge if you haven't seen one. And being an enthusiast photographer himself, these huge camera systems for landscapes were not an option for Mr. Barnack since he had asthma and, as you know, it's kind of hard to hike in the mountains with a big ass 8x10 behind your back when you cannot breathe. So he decided to use the parts from a cinema rig to make his own little pocketable camera. Now the point was to use an existing 35mm film and the rollers that would fit the film perforation. The genius was in turning the strip 90 degrees and move from vertical to horizontal advancing. So before, the cinema camera would have the vertical strip of film inside that would capture the lens projection. By the way, 35mm refers to the overall width of the strip. The actual area of projection is 18x24mm, which is, you guessed it, has 4:3 aspect ratio, a common ratio for silent film era. Later, more aspect ratios were introduced over time for various reasons. For example, more narrow frames allowed to have more place to record an audio track or to save space to get more frames out of the same length of film. On the opposite, more square ratios were needed for anamorphic lenses to allow de-squeezing of the image. In other words, you can get lost in cinema aspect ratios, and I'm not gonna play Alice here. If you want to explore it more deeply, you can jump into the rabbit hole on your own. What matters to us is that now Oskar had a horizontal film strip in his little camera, and using the cinema rig rollers gave precision, but to have a horizontal frame, you have to advance them twice. Therefore, instead of 18x24, now we have 24x36mm frame. That is why probably the early Leica M3 model models were double stroke, since one stroke gave you the vertical cine frame and the second one would achieve 24x36. And now with this frame, that many photographers now call full frame, we have an aspect ratio of 3:2, which, let's be honest, stinks. It is too wide for horizontal shots and definitely too tall for vertical shots. And something tells me that Barnack was well aware of this problem, since the very first shot he made with his new little camera called Ur-Leica already seemed to benefit a bit from a more square crop. I mean, look at that negative space, come on. But at the time, his goal was not to achieve perfect ratio, he just wanted a small and capable camera for himself, and I definitely respect him for that. Just imagine that you want something so bad that you have to invent it yourself. He didn't mind cropping, and instead of trying to fix aspect ratio, he started to deal with the lens problem, which, as you can understand, non-existed for the new system. And I don't blame him for letting that 3:2 happen, given the circumstances. It was just easier to use existing cinema film advances instead of inventing new ones. And don't you dare think that Barnack was the only one coming up with a compact 35mm photo camera. Around that time, there were tons of others who tried to do the same. And actually, there were quite a few of them that offered more adequate aspect ratios like 24x24, 32x24 and 30x40. But unfortunately, all of them remained just prototypes because of the same reasons. The custom film advance systems made from scratch were too bulky, and such big cameras could not compete with those who had already refined cinema advances inside of them. The price for it was the odd 3:2 ratio, but given the success and popularity of Leica cameras and epic failure of others who didn't follow Leica's recipe, closer to the beginning of World War II, everyone kind of settled with 24x36mm negatives. Fast forward to 40s and 50s, after the war and fall of Germany, many companies truly understood the need for small, high-quality compact cameras and the potential market. And since nobody would care about a defeated post-war country or its company, many of them would freely use Leica's engineering decisions and lens mount. Russians even went as far as copying completely everything, down to the smallest screws, and then slapping their communist brand on it, something like GZR-32B. Nikon, however, was still trying to push the proper 24x32 aspect ratio with their Nikon 1 rangefinder, and it made sense. Anyway, you would most likely crop your standard 24x36 frame, so with Nikon 1 you could get better composing and get 40 instead of 36 exposures out of a standard roll. Unfortunately, the General Headquarters, aka American folks in charge of the occupied post-war Japan, banned export of them to the US. The official reason was that the automatic color slide cutting machines used in the US were set up to fit Leica's 24x36 format, unlike Japanese machines that were using 24x32. But in reality, Kodak, as a strong monopolist of photographic film and formats at the time, simply made sure that Nikon 1 never makes it to the American market. And so Nikon first tried to solve the problem by increasing the frame size from 24x32 to 24x34, without compromising the camera body structure too much. Later, they would just give up and introduce a now legendary full-frame 24x36 Nikon S2. After that, basically, there were no attempts to correct that stupid-ass 3:2 ratio. At the same time, true photographic film and cameras for shooting it kept their much better aspect ratios with sizes like 6:4.5, 6:6, 6:7, and 8:10, most of them revolve around 4:3 ratio. With the emergence of a digital era, aps-c and then full-frame sensors were developed with classic film 3:2 ratio in mind. And yes, you heard it right. First came aps-c sensor, so who's daddy now, huh? About same time, Mamiya introduced first digital medium format camera, and guess what? They also went with the original medium format film's 4:3 ratio. All the medium format cameras today have a very nice and flexible 4:3 aspect ratio sensor. Another bright spot in this aspect ratio mess is a Micro Four Thirds system. Developed together by Olympus and Panasonic, it is the first camera imaging system developed from scratch. Unlike others, it was intended to be digital. And no surprise, with freedom of choice, they chose the 4:3 design for their sensors. Besides just the right size of the frame for better composition and common print sizes, there's also a very important engineering aspect that applies to medium format as well. More square sensor allows for much smaller and better performing lenses. The image circle is used much more efficiently than the one of full frame or aps-c. So here we are now. What started as a heritage and a nod to a film photography era becomes a burden that companies seem to just blindly keep on carrying. Although we have systems with 4:3 aspect ratios, still the dominant aps-c and full frame cameras are executing the same silly 3:2 format that sometimes just pisses me off in post. We are paying for over-engineered lenses to produce an image circle that we, as photographers, use only partially, but the price of the R&D and the useless extra weight of glass is purely on us. While medium format does not offer currently what I want, and Micro Four Thirds being more and more video-centric, not to say that it's kind of dying off these days, as a photographer I have to go with 3:2 images. There are workarounds. I could stretch the image, fill in the space with Photoshop or simply crop, but I cannot stop thinking how nice it would be like to get the same sensor area but with different aspect ratio. Besides convenience, we would probably get much better and smaller lenses for the aps-c and full frame systems. But all of that is never gonna happen, and all we can do is just follow the stream. I know, some may argue that 3:2 is perfectly fine and there is no need to crop, just compose with what you have. But isn't that restraining? I honestly can't remember the last time I didn't have to crop the picture. The world is not meant to be captured in that stupidly long rectangular box. Well, I hope this episode got you educated a little bit. Personally, I was curious about it and the research was quite fun. If you feel the same way, hit the like button. These history behind series are most interesting to do, but if you ask me, they don't get the deserved views for some reason, so head over to the playlist and check out more episodes like this. That will get you busy until our next time. See ya!